First scripture lesson this morning is from the book of Numbers, chapter 11, verses 24 through 30. So Moses went out and told the people the words of the Lord, and he gathered 70 elders of the people and placed them all around the tent. Then the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to him, and took some of the spirit that was on him and put it on the 70 elders. And when the spirit rested upon them, they prophesied. But they did not do so again. Two men remained in the camp, one named Eldad and the other named Medad, and the spirit rested on them. They were among those registers, but they had not gone out to the tent, and so they prophesied in the camp. And the young man ran and told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp." And Joshua, son of Nun, the assistant of Moses, one of his chosen men, said, "My lord, Moses, stop them." But Moses said to him, "Are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the Lord's people were prophets, and that the Lord would put his spirit on all of them." And Moses and the elders of Israel returned to their camp. Our second scripture lesson for today is from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem, and at this sound the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? How is it that we hear, each of us, in our own native language, Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power." All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They're filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "People of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you. Listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." Here ends our reading. If you'll please pray with me. Holy Spirit, fall upon us now. May your fire light our souls up, so that the words I speak and the meditations of all our hearts are pleasing unto you. Amen. As I was thinking about this sermon this week, I was trying to come up with what a good metaphor for what happened at Pentecost would be. I thought, maybe it's kind of like when something bad happens, but it turns out that there's good out of it, you know. And I thought about the Blackhawks losing the first round to the Nashville Predators. And that's a bad thing. None of us can deny that. But the fact that I moved to Nashville, or to Tennessee, to Knoxville here, and I'm such a huge hockey fan, maybe the fact that Nashville's now in the Stanley Cup Finals, more people are going to get into hockey. So I'll have more people to talk hockey with, people who know hockey. That's a good thing. But I thought, no, because the Blackhawks losing in round one is really just terrible, and there's no way around that. Then I thought, okay, maybe it's like how we had to suffer through the terrible Superman movie, Man of Steel, and then the worst movie, Batman vs. Superman, but out of that we got Wonder Woman, which might be the greatest superhero movie ever made. But then I thought, no, because Man of Steel and Batman vs. Superman, what they do to the characters of Batman and Superman are so egregious and so horrible that there's just, even though we got good out of it, there's too much bad there to really make this metaphor work. And I realized that those things I was thinking about were really more metaphors for the resurrection. And maybe I was still in that Easter mindset, which isn't a bad thing, because that is part of what Easter is about, right? That even when horrible things happen, like the Blackhawks losing in round one, or having to sit through Man of Steel and Batman vs. Superman, God can make good come out of it, like more people getting into hockey and Wonder Woman. Even with the crucifixion and the death of Jesus, God's still working and good comes out of that. We get the resurrection and the realization that death is not the end and evil doesn't win. God's not done yet, right? That's where that metaphor fits. And that's important, and we are an Easter people, and that's always important, but that's not really what we're talking about today. So, well, let's look at the Numbers scripture for a second for a clue. I like this text, especially in kind of concert with the Acts Pentecost text, because we see what happens when the Spirit works amongst a group of people. Everybody else gets really freaked out, right? We have somebody running to Moses like, they are prophesying to the camp, Moses, we have got to stop this. And Joshua's like, stop them, man, stop them, right? And Moses, luckily, he gets it. He realizes it's not about him. It's about what God's doing. And he realizes, I wish that everyone would feel the Spirit upon them. I wish that everyone would start prophesying. I wish everyone would get on board with what God is doing. You know, when I thought about that, I thought maybe I know where my metaphor is. The people who represent us are literal representatives. The government, they're supposed to represent us. And so it's in the name, right? They're representatives. And yet, politicians, and this is on both sides of the aisle, I'm not being partisan one way or the other, this is everybody, they all represent themselves. They represent the people, well, the money, really, that they get. They represent corporations, they represent lobbyists, they don't represent us. And that's the whole system. But here's the thing, what Moses got, and what none of us seem to, is that we're the ones with the power, the people. The system is broken, there's no denying that, but we do have the power to fix it. We could literally vote every single person in office out, if we wanted to, every single one of them. And then if we elect people who end up falling into the same traps and listening to the money, we could vote them out too, and we could keep doing it until we got people who actually represented us, the people, who actually cared more about the people that they represent. Taking care of basic needs, like the government is supposed to, like health care. The planet, our environment, rather than worrying about their own checkbooks. We have that power if we acknowledge it, if we use it, and really kind of that's what Pentecost is about. Let's look at Acts. They're all gathered together in a room on Pentecost. Now, Pentecost was a thing before the whole Spirit coming down in the fire. That's what we associated with now, is this event, that we read about in Acts, but Pentecost was the thing before that. Pentecost really means 50 days. And conveniently, this Pentecost event is supposedly about 50 days after Easter. But before that, Pentecost was a thing. It meant 50 days, and it was 50 days after the Passover. Because remember when Jesus gathered with his disciples as he's about to be crucified, they were celebrating the Passover. And that then led us to Easter. And so here we are 50 days later. So it kind of makes sense. It lines up. And the Hebrew understanding is that Mount Sinai, and so we're back to Moses again, getting the tablets, the Ten Commandments, was 50 days after Passover and their escape from Egypt. So Passover is this celebration of God giving the law. So it really kind of ties in, because now Passover is the celebration of us realizing that God is working through us to do what God is doing in the world. A little more context on that Numbers piece. And you guys know, if you were here for the first sermon I preached after I was officially hired, was I'm really big on context. If you remember, Jesus drove a Honda, never talked about it. For Jesus did not speak of his own accord. We need context. So Moses, the reason that the Spirit comes upon these 70 elders is because people are complaining. They're out in the desert. They've been out there a while. They're like, we don't have enough food. And Moses is like, everyone's complaining. And God's like, they're going to have so much meat, they won't know what to do with themselves. That's literally what God says. And Moses is like, how? Where? What? You know, how is this going to happen? Right after this, we get the answer to that, right after our scripture for today. We see what God does. But Moses is like, look, they're going to revolt. I need help. And so we get the 70 elders, and the Spirit comes upon them. And Moses isn't alone in what he's trying to do. And that's very much what we're seeing here in Acts, right? The 12 can't do it on their own. Jesus was working in the world, but that work's going to continue even though Jesus isn't here anymore. Last week we saw the ascension, we saw Jesus left, but he said, power is going to come upon you, you've got work to do. And that's what we're seeing, but they can't do it alone. So the Spirit falls on everyone. It's really unruly. Like, they're in a room, and the entire city basically has to go figure out what's going on. I mean, they say the entire city gathers around, like, what's going on in there? So it's unruly. In fact, it's so unruly that there are some people who are like, oh, they must be drunk. They must have gotten into the good stuff. Now, I love Peter's reasoning for why they're not drunk. It's 9 o'clock in the morning. Clearly, Peter didn't know about college football or noon game starts. Because I don't know how it is here, but I'm betting that at 9 a.m. on a Saturday where there's a noon game start, you got some people who are into the new one. But the Spirit shakes people up, makes them question, makes them wonder what's going on. Why is that? Because the Spirit working, the church doing its job, continuing the work of Christ, threatens the status quo. It threatens the powers that be. Bring good news to the poor. Bring release to the captives. Bring sight to the blind. Let the oppressed go free. Bring the year of Jubilee. That's Jesus quoting the book of Isaiah. And Luke, who, remember, we talked about this last week, also wrote Acts. Luke gives us Jesus interpreting that basically as his mission statement. So for Luke, or whoever wrote Luke and Acts, this is the mission statement of Jesus and now the church. Bring good news to the poor. Bring release to the captives. Bring sight to the blind. Let the oppressed go free. Bring the year of Jubilee. Do you guys know what the year of Jubilee is?
Yes.
So in Jewish tradition, if you had to sell part of your land or sell yourself into slavery or give up some of your things to survive, every 50 years there's the year of Jubilee. Supposedly, this in practice didn't really work, but the idea was every 50 years you go back and everybody gets back. The people who have sold themselves into slavery are freed. The people who had to sell their land get their land back. The people who had to give up some of their possessions get their possessions back. It's a status quo. It's a cleaning. It returns the world to the way it's supposed to be. So you hear what Jesus is saying his mission statement is? Bring good news to the poor. Bring sight to the blind. Let the oppressed go free and bring the year of Jubilee. That's some heavy stuff. That's the people who are in power, the people who are oppressing, the people who aren't poor. This doesn't sound like good news to those people. This is upsetting to the people in power. When the Holy Spirit is coming to assist in doing this, of course people are going to take notice. Of course someone's going to run to Moses and say, you got to stop them. If everyone is prophesying, what good are you, Moses? What good is the system we have set up? That's what God's here to do, is overturn these systems that we've created. And when we accepted our calls at baptism, we recognized our role. Yeah, we were baptized in water, but more than that, we were baptized by the Holy Spirit. Just like the church on Pentecost. And you know, this is not a one-time thing. This Holy Spirit coming in the flames, and yeah, it's spectacular, it's cinematic almost, right? You can visualize it. It's the birthday of the church that we like to celebrate, but it's not a one-time thing. If we keep going in Acts, we see it happen again and again and again and again, where the Holy Spirit shows up purifying and empowering God's people. It's a sign of God's ongoing presence for those who are continuing Jesus' work. And we said yes to that when we were baptized. That work includes us. We need the Spirit to be working in us. What does that look like? Well, it looks like challenging the status quo, worrying the powers that be, bringing good news to the poor, bringing release to the captives, bringing sight to the blind, letting the oppressed go free, bringing the year of Jubilee. What does it look like to have the Spirit on fire inside of us? It means we make the world look at us, take notice of us, gather around, say, what's going on in there? Are they drunk? No. There's no UT football game today. We're just exhibiting the Holy Spirit. We're continuing the disruptive work of Christ. Let's go. It's 9 o'clock somewhere.